19th of May 2014. We were up on Beautiful Girl by Dana, as we are many, many nights for the last 6 months, rallying, trying to sort out the facts from the fission fiction, like bananas. And you can catch this stream, if you catch it, in the comments or to your left of you with a small screen player. And the comments are rolling by. We are live streaming and you should join into the conversation. And I usually start off warming up, waiting for everything to sync up by saying hi to as many people as I can. I check the audio. Hang on.
You're up on Beautiful Girl by Dana.
And we are good to go right there. Hi, Lori. Hi, Lunar. Mr. I Can See Candace. Piano Precious. Miss Frill, hi. John Earth, Miss Phil's got a blog up there, folks. You should check out John Townsend. Hi, bud. Mr. I Can See again. MSVS, what's up? Mr. I Can See too. Kevin O'Kane. Bob. Hi, Grandma. MSVS, Toxic. Lori. Good evening, folks. Bubba. Fukushima Revelations. Rick. Oh, David. Who else we got here? Kate. Hi, Kate. Kate runs Fukushima Hounds. You'll find links below. And just link below. Check out her site. She's now a blogger. And she's awesome. And you really got to like her site over there. There's a lot of people over there. It's independent from me. Kate running the site. And has put a lot of work into it. And she needs that support because she's making a difference and has put the time, energy, and effort and monetary into that. And that's to be respected. And like everybody else out here, like Miss Milky, like Nubru Magic, like Kevin Blanche, like Thomas Ackerman, you know, like Susan Ducos down below from Before It's News, who supported us tirelessly and has been out there hammering away, like Radiation Chick, Christina Consolo, Rad Chick. You'll find her on YouTube under that handle, and you'll find her on Climate Viewer, and you'll find those links below. And you'll find Lori and Missing Sky 101, and you will find all kinds of people that are perpetual motion machines right now, that because of their souls and their hearts are so big that they care more about this entire planet than everything else, and they're willing to fight for it at all cost. And there's so many of you folks here. Hi, Standing Foot. And we got Mickey, Mass Sterilization. Hey, bud. And that's a good name, hey, Mass Sterilization, because that's what they're up to. I've never seen a banana mutate a fruit fly. Have you seen a banana mutate a fruit fly? I know I haven't. And you won't. Because a banana's got nothing to do with the radiation that we talk about. And every night we have to apologize consistently, constantly. Hi, Adam. Hi, Liz, Kathy, Nepkiller, Adam, Ayul, Chris Cashin, Sir Car, I can't pronounce your name, you know that. We've been down this road before. And Eile Yusut, I never get your name, can I? After all these months, I still can't do it. Hi, Sergeant. And you folks are perpetual motion machines, yourselves. And the picture you see there is actually a picture of me in a Superman costume that somebody done up for me a while back. Shake Pie, you'll find him in my music section. Fantastic, inconceivably. And like, he's extremely talented for recording. Really, really talented people. And he had done that one up for me. I just listed all your favorite channels, Adam. Well, then you definitely know a thing or two, you know. And we'll be picking your mind later. Hi, Lori, Checks and Balances. And everybody, let's get started. It usually takes us 5 minutes. Oh, we're only 4 minutes and 38 seconds. Man, I got a couple more people out there. Got to say hi before I can give it up. Who's out there? Yeah, I see the numbers are starting to grow. Everybody knows I don't start till the first 4 or 5 minutes. So everybody's like, Dana's going to be yakking his head off. for the first 5 minutes. It's the same thing every show, isn't it? That's pretty funny. Everybody got me worked out. So does that mean I got to stop doing that at the beginning of every show, doing my warm-up, my preamble to my screaming? Yeah? Calm you law, it's okay. Yeah. No, I hear you. You'll sit. Call you. See, and now you got two L's here. I haven't got no glasses on. How am I supposed to pronounce that? Do I look like a nuclear scientist to you or something? Huh? You probably got a truck waiting to start the truck. See, I didn't see that comment that until I looked up and I was talking to you. Start the truck. Look, I was coming down the road today and I seen a truck, and first I seen all these people running, because obviously they seen the truck before I did. And so they were running, and I was like, man, maybe this is a truck. Maybe this is the real thing. Right? Not about Joe, but it's every man for, it's every person for themselves when you see a truck. Because like WIPP in New Mexico repository, when they had that radiation release, massive radiation release. Well, before that, for 9 days, they had had a truck fire, 9 days previous, rather. And for 9 days, they didn't go back down in the WIPP repository where all the uranium-238, because that's what most of that is. It's not americium and it's not plutonium. Plutonium is just a tiny percentage. Do you think they're burying all this stuff that is transgenic, that is insignificant radiation, a half a mile underground? You think that they're going to put this stupid shit? You know, you really got to take it into context. What's sitting on your ground? What's sitting at hand for it? There's 450 billion gallons dumped into the soil. They're not even in containers. And by the way, everything at WIPP is vented. So everybody that works at WIPP in 10 or 15 or 20 years is going to get tumors and cysts. Anyway, I guess they were hoping they would all be down in the mine when it collapsed and they wouldn't have to pay out those medical expenses. But tough luck on that. Because you had a truck fire and everybody bailed for 9 days, right, at WIPP. I mean, that's a perpetual motion machine if I ever seen one, is a truck fire. So you have a truck fire and you got to abandon your cities and your highways and your communities. Do you really think we should have trucks anywhere in North America? Let's send them back to the hell they came from. You know, we should have an online campaign at the White House to ban pickup trucks and trucks. Like, if you're going to have to go abandon a huge, massive mine like at the WIPP repository in New Mexico, Carlsbad, because of a truck fire, think about, like, your car lot. That could probably take out most of North America if it goes up. Because they're trucks. And you say, Dana, that's foolishness. No, they evacuated the WIPP, that big site, hundreds of people, because of a truck fire. And they never went back down there, not even into the buildings on that massive site. Think about a site. Think about a football field. Well, there's 55 of those under the ground a half a mile down. And now when you have a truck fire, you think about how big these places are, right? The tunnels themselves, where they have the trucks. And there's massive wind going one direction, right? And so all you had normally would have done in a normal, like if it was a car, you could have got behind the car and put the car fire out. But because it was a truck fire, right, you had to abandon the site. And then they probably made up a radiation release. There's probably no radiation release at WIPP. It was the fucking truck. And they don't want to tell you that because there's trucks all over the highway. And trucks in your community. You go and look around. You'll see them everywhere. They're out there. I seen one today. Okay, I can't keep going like that. Sorry. Yeah, that's Al-Qaeda stuff, you know. Saying that trucks are bad. Just like saying radiation is bad. That no matter what you do, you can't escape it. Hi, Sean. And everybody else, let me come over and say, they got to ban iPhone chargers too. Right? Just because WIPP said it's cool and it's trendy and everybody's got to do it, you got to lick that iPhone charger. Yeah, lick their fucking iPhone chargers. Because WIPP said it's cool. They said at the WIPP repository that you would get more radiation if you licked your iPhone charger, from licking your iPhone charger, And if I had my wire cast running, blah, that's got me ran to the ground. It's been a rough couple of weeks trying to get that shit to work, you know. It really took the good out of me. But I'm still pounding away at it. Oh, let me get rid of that. And I was doing a wire cast today to make a documentary for everybody. And I got a new, I can't tell you because, but I couldn't find a picture of it on the internet. And so I created one, and it's authentic picture, and I'm not going to tell you anymore because I'm going to try to get that video out tonight. After we stream, I'm going to sit there and do the audio. I don't care what it's like. I don't care how bad it is. I'm just going to put it out there, no matter what. It's coming out tonight. I got to stay up all night. That little short video is going to come out. And I'm going to be creating a lot of these short videos. I'll get busy here in a second, folks. And I know everybody really don't care, but the people don't know any better. You know, the WIPP repository had released a massive amount of radiation. They blamed it on, and they said nothing happened for 9 days. And they said they had a truck fire, and that's why they didn't go back down in the mine. And, you know me, I'm a curious kind of a guy. And I've seen Hollywood movies, and they have truck fires, and people didn't have to evacuate big areas. And so I was like, well, maybe I better go out and look this stuff up. And then I seen a picture on the internet of firefighters putting the truck out, and I think that was photoshopped. I think they photoshopped it, uploaded it to the internet to fool people like us. Because trucks are the most dangerous things on the planet. Not the 45-gallon barrels of uranium-238 with americium, neptunium, plutoniums, and all their daughters with the thousands of years of half-life. And by the way, a half-life is times 10 minimum. So if it's whatever it is, it's times 10. So why do they call it a half-life in the context of when they're explaining things to you then? Amongst themselves, because they know academically what it means, it's okay, right? But to come out and constantly deceive you for 70 years, and now we find out that half-life is times 10. So if it's a 30-year half-life for strontium and cesium, and strontium goes right into your bones, right? It goes into your groin, gets in, which because you're making your white blood cells down there, and you're making your bone marrow there. Well, you make white blood cells everywhere actually in your joints, not only your spleen. I ain't got no spleen. I don't need no stinking spleen. Yeah, I got mine taken out when I was young. Like, you know how most people go out and get a tattoo? I went out and got my spleen removed. Because I thought that was more trendy. I'm pretty tough, right? I don't have no friggin' anesthetic. Just reach in there and get that old spleen out of me. I want to pickle it and put it on my shelf. And today, that's where it sits. On a dusty old shelf on the east coast of Canada. Sitting there right now, because nobody else got a use for it, I can assure you. You think I'm making that up, don't you? Okay, well, I made a little tiny bit of that part up. Actually, I lost my spleen in a motorcycle accident. And I slid up the handlebars and slammed into a... And the handlebars went in my stomach. And then the bike flipped. And it tossed me about 25 feet or something. About 10 feet up in the air and on a bank. And so I started to bleed to death. Because I had ruptured my spleen, tore from my body cavity, right? And so the bike was down there screaming. I don't know why I'm telling you this story, but anyway, the bike was down there screaming. And so I kept passing out. And I would wake up and I hear the bike. And so I try to go to the bike to shut it off. And I pass out again. I'd done that probably 20 times. And so by and by I got to the bike. And then I drove the bike to the first house, and the bike was all smashed up, and I went in, and the girl who came out, she thought I was faking, and her dad came out, and she was like 25 or something, I don't know why she thought that, but anyway, her dad came out, and he looked at the bike, and he called her an idiot or something, and he said, get the car keys. And so he realized this was serious, and he took me to the hospital. And every rock in the road, I felt it. I don't know why I'm telling you this, but... So anyway, I get in the hospital, And it's my spleen. I had lost, I can't remember how much blood, but lost a lot of blood in my cavity. So it was filled up. I had turned gold colors. And I had said to the doctor, they were doing an x-ray, and I said, I'm going to puke. And he said, no, you're not. And I covered him in puke. Just, bah! And he laughed at me. And so did the nurses, because I told him I was going to puke, and he wouldn't give me a bucket, and I puked. It was lucky for me anyway, right? And so I had surgery, and broke. The bike never ran again. So the bike made it out. It kept running, right? And so it consciously woke me up each time. And finally, I made it out and got on the bike. I pulled the clutch in, dropped the gear down. I drove it out to the first house, and that bike never started again. And it was not even good for scrap. But it ran perfect out to that first house. I remember that distinctly. Anyway, let me keep going. There was a point to me telling you that story, by the way. I don't know what it is anymore. Oh, yeah. It was the first ride of spring, and I was coming down a hill, and the rain had washed out the bank, and there was a rock sticking out of the bank, but it was still covered in mud, so you couldn't notice it. And so there's a big, huge, massive puddle of water there and mud. And I went up alongside the bank, and the tire hit that and then turned, and then I slid up and stuck the handlebars in my guts and threw me for a somersault. But prior to that, I used to go out and drive around town and look for cop cars and get them to chase me. I had XL500, and I bought the biggest, knobbiest tires I could at a North American, ordered them, brought them in there, and got them all nice and pretty. And I used to go out and look for them. And there was nothing I wouldn't do like more than go out and find the boys in blue and get them to try to chase me. And so that's how bored we were. That's after I had moved over to the other side of Newfoundland when I was older. That's what I thought. That's what I considered fun. And I had done that, I know, about 16 times in just one period. And I mean, if things had got dangerous, I would have stopped. That was always the plan, right? But there was no way to catch me. And so these guys are from the mainland, and they don't know the territory. And I knew all the locals, and I knew the territory, and they couldn't go where I could. So it was just about aggravating them. But in those days, the police wouldn't beat you up. Police wouldn't pull a gun on you. Police wouldn't pick you up and throw you down on your head till your head was cracked open and you died. Right? If they didn't get you, they didn't get you. Now they would send up the drones and everything else. But they won't go look for Fukushima. They won't go look at all the radiation as I really landed in this country, in North America. No, I talk about Canada, and I talk about United States, and I don't talk about Vietnam. I don't talk about the Baltic Sea. I don't talk about a lot of the other countries. I kind of broach on it a little bit here and there, but I don't. That doesn't become part of the narrative, and we should always, you know, take that into account when you're thinking about Fukushima. It's not just Japan. It's not just Canada. We're already privileged beyond imagination. And it's not the Americans. And they're privileged beyond imaginations. And Americans are using up about 26% of the resources used every year, every day, on this planet. Just under 5% of the population, right? But I just wanted to run through the headlines, and there it is. I'm transferring everything onto the other the new computer. Now, when I talk about jet streams, I want you to remember one thing, that they're real, and that they're well known, and that even though the apologists, the nuclear bootlickers out there don't want to talk about it, because that's too tangible. You can understand a jet stream. At 100 miles an hour in 24 hours is 2,400 miles. In 2 days, in 4,800, is 4,800 miles. In 3 days, it's halfway across North America. So if it's coming from Japan, in the air, it's 24 hours, 2,400 miles. If it's coming in the sea, in 1 day, it's going to move about 24 miles because the currents move at a mile per hour. And so the currents at a mile per hour, perpetual motion machine, every day it's hemorrhaging into the ocean at the rate of about 1,000 pounds of radioactive, think of radioactive dye like St. Paddy's Day going into the ocean or into a 4,000 mile river. And so you're at the top of that 4,000 mile river, you're going to dump every minute one truckload into the river. You got to get the truck out of the way, another truck out of backup, dump it in. You're going to do that every minute, nonstop, like a perpetual motion machine until the end of time. And as you, as years roll by, year one, that's a lot of dye. How far down that river do you think at the end of the year you're going to go before you stop seeing dye? If it's 4,000 miles long and you dump dye, you know, a truckload of dye that didn't solute into the water, it wasn't solutable, didn't dissolve, it maintained its color and its intensity, and it was radioactive. Because radiation is invisible and you can't see it, smell it, hear it, pick it up, taste it, feel it, kick it around, play with it, bite it, smack it, put it in your pocket, you don't know, it could be there. It seems innocuous and benign, right? But it's not. Because it's so small that it's smaller than the dust in your house that floats around in the air. It's smaller than that. And you need a really sunny day and bright windows to see that dust in your house. And but it's much smaller than that. It's at 1/10,000th of a millionth of a meter. And that stuff is only microns. We're not even down to the nanoparticles with the stuff you can see. Once it gets down to the nanos, you can't see it. But it gets down to the sub-nanos, it gets down to 1/10,000th of a millionth of a meter, and you need extraordinarily sophisticated devices. So I want you to think about it. That if you got a Geiger counter, and so Geiger counter got some uses, even though I don't put them on much of a pedestal, but they got a lot of uses, because at least they can make you aware. And if you're in a really bad area, it will probably save your life. And so there's nothing wrong with it, but you have to learn how to use it. Remember a Geiger counter that if you sniff it inappropriately, I know that sounds pretty naughty, but if you use what you call sniffing, because it sniffs into particles, and then they have to react with the gases that are in there, right? And so what you got to remember going on there is that you can excite these things and throw it off its calibration. And by rights, you should have it calibrated to look for specific isotopes, to find them, the ones you're not going to be released. But you're looking for gammas or you're looking for betas. Most of the Geiger counters out there are not looking for both of those, but they can, some of them. And it's not going to tell you what it is. But so a long story short would be that if I had a glass of water and it had 7,500 becquerels potassium 40 in it, and I had another glass of water and it had 7,500 becquerels potassium 40, and it had a single atom or a particle of cesium-137 or strontium or any of these other man-made radioactive isotopes, and you took your Geiger counter, when you put it up to the one with just the drinking water, and you drank the 7,500 becquerels of potassium 40, you off-gassed that because it's homeostasis and it's insignificant. Your body can't hold any more potassium 40. But the Geiger counter can't read that. You got to take a cubic meter of water, you have to dry it out, weigh the potassium 40, and for every gram, you're going to put 25 becquerels of potassium 40 into the equation. But everything got potassium 40 into it. So the other glass, now it's got potassium 40, so your Geiger counter is not going to work on that either. But if it's got becquerels of cesium or strontium or uranium or plutonium or any of the creatures, any of the 3,100 or the, say there's 3,100 isotopes, 260 of them are normal. And they're so benign, so harmless, so insignificant, one has to wonder why we keep hearing these words. So you can take your Geiger counter, you're not going to find thorium, you know, that kelp watch, the UC Berkeley was talking about. You got to dry it out, right, and weigh the stuff out. You're not going to find barium-7 on your Geiger counter because it's so insignificant. It's indigenous. It's solar rays. It's stupid. But that one with the cesium-137, your Geiger counter is going to go beep every second. And if there's 7,500 becquerels of cesium in there, your Geiger counter is going to go every second. Now, if you drink, now say you got none of this stuff in you, and you take the Geiger counter and you go up to yourself and you go, yeah, I got no beep beeps going on here. with the Geiger counter on your body. Just, like, I want you to think that way anyway. Even though that might not be true because of the way they detect these things, you got to take your kidney out and dissect it and everything else. But I just want you to escape that train of thought so that you can actually understand what I'm trying to say to you. Is that if you drink the one with the cesium-137 in it, right, you're going to have a Becquerel inside of you, an extra Becquerel. So your body can't hold any more potassium-40, but there's no limit on how much cesium you can put in your body. There's no homeostasis attached to the cesium. And there was 30 times more strontium with the cesium. 30 times more. And a lot of people say, where's your proof that this stuff came across? Well, evidence of sharp features in the Fukushima plume over southwestern British Columbia was a study by Health Canada. And you'll find links below the video. And I remember to put the links there tonight. And I got the links in under the last one. Because I forget sometimes too. Several studies on the radioactive release in Fukushima nuclear power plant already exist. The Fukushima plume, this is Health Canada, March the 18th and the 19th. The Fukushima plume provided a nice opportunity to test radioactivity detection capabilities. That's the most twisted thing imaginable. We didn't pay them to get out there and test it and find it and not tell us. We gave them all that equipment. We gave them all that funding. We gave them their pensions and their paychecks. We gave them those offices and those trucks. And just think about how dangerous those things are. We allowed them to drive them around. And they can contaminate the Northern Hemisphere if you have an accident with a truck. But we have so much confidence in them, we let them drive the trucks around. And then they find all this radioactive plumes. Massive. Unbelievable sizes. In updating your coastline, like an invisible snowstorm that lingered over your coastline. And you remember how I covered the Trans-Pacific pollution, how it gets exported across the Pacific, to the Pacific corridor, the wind corridors, not even getting up into the jet streams, even though it does, but the pollution from the buses and the trucks in the other countries, they got trucks down there. See, we need a campaign on this planet to ban trucks, not nuclear misery, nuclear nightmare, nuclear agony, nuclear enemas, because that's what you're doing to yourself. You're destroying yourself with this technology that provides 3% of electricity on this planet. You're destroying the planet because there's no creature on this planet can deal with this. Now, you got this hemorrhaging into the ocean. Go and verify it yourself. You find it in all kinds of mainstream media. You got Unit 1, 2, and 3, 100% meltdowns, 100%. Unit 1 lost its top. Unit 2 is intact, but no one will ever get in there again. And he built another sarcophagus around it. Because you will never see people working on these with scaffolding, with cutting torches. You won't see scaffold connection or steeplejack down there putting bids on that or working on it. You won't see the carpenter hall sending guys out to Fukushima to do construction. You're not going to see any rebuilding because the whole freaking place detonated one right after another. Unit 3 is missing. That was MOX fuel. 2 million times worse than any other reactor on the planet. 2 million times worse. Let me say that 2 million times. 2 million times worse than any other reactor on this planet, including Chernobyl. And by far Chernobyl. Chernobyl was nothing. It's nothing. It was one-third the size of any of the reactors at Fukushima. It was a 30% meltdown of any of the reactors at Fukushima. Fukushima's are 100% meltdowns. So right away, they're three times worse. The fuel they're using at Fukushima is completely different. They're using graphite at Chernobyl. Chernobyl's got 3,600 square kilometers exclusion zone. And then the levels of cesium that they're talking about, the EPA in North America says you're allowed 7,400 becquerels a cubic meter in your drinking water. That's more than a cubic meter in the exclusion zone of Chernobyl. But Ken Buesler and Woods Hole Oceanographic Institution, Jay Cullen, all these other idiots, stupid dummies, murderers, maggots, parasites, cowards, stalkers, freaks, burden upon our society. They equate all this stuff with, hey, ingest or getting an x-ray. Well, if you ingest it, you're getting an x-ray for the rest of your life, nonstop. When you get an x-ray, you walk out of the room, bye-bye, x-ray, kiss my butt, you know. I ain't scared of no x-ray. I'm terrified of ingesting radioactive particles because it sequesters into your organs. Living in an environment that we're living in now with high becquerels of cubic meters throughout North America is unimaginable. 50 becquerels cause permanent organ lesions living in that environment of man-made. These isotopes don't exist on the moon. They don't exist on the sun. The sun doesn't create these isotopes. It creates elements. We destroy elements and create these creatures that don't exist in our solar system. They're not in our periodic tables. Yeah, we're trying to sketch them in now all these years later so people don't understand. But the entire nuclear industry is made up of lies and propaganda. Why do they have to come out and claim that a banana has something to do with a man-made radioactive isotope for it? Why do you have to come out and claim that walking in the sunshine has something to do with man-made radioactive isotopes for? Why do they got to come out and claim that potatoes are one of the most radioactive food on the planet? And we eat it all the time and it doesn't hurt us. So why should we worry about releases from these man-made radioactive materials? Because they don't exist in our solar system. Because if you have a glass of drinking water, or a glass of water from the ocean, a glass of water from the ocean, you got 75 to 100 million phytoplankton. That's the very basis of the food chain. That's the very basis of oxygen. And if you take that out of the equation, everything else collapses. It's the house of cards. It's that one card in the house of cards will take the whole friggin' thing down. And we're not supposed to worry about it. We're supposed to put our fate that the system out there has our best interest in mind. When the hell was that ever a good idea? Would you run a company saying, oh, I won't check on my employees. They got my best interest in heart. I'll just leave my money sitting there. I'll just leave the beer coolers wide open. And I'll go on down on vacation. And I'm not going to worry about it. Because nobody would fucking do shit like that, right? Because we live in a perfect world where most of these people got the job, got the education so they can be a vulture, so they can get their hands on a checkbook, so they can get access to federal funding, because they couldn't get a job serving french fries. They couldn't get a job sweeping my floor. I wouldn't feel safe with them on my street. I wouldn't feel safe with a nuclear scientist like a propagandist, apologist, in my community. Unless he was swinging from a pole. Legally, of course. Right, and I fully say that when I'm elected to president of the New World Order, we're going to make all our telephone poles with windmills on the top of them and good old-fashioned hanging hooks for all the apologists out there, because there is war crimes, tribunals, and crimes coming down the road for these creatures, for what they've done to that ocean, for what they're doing to this planet, for what they've done to our countries, for what our governments have done to us. For what? It's not our government, because they don't know any better, and they're stifled, a lot of them, by national security laws. You can't really blame a lot of these people, because they can't open their mouth, because under the national security, they could be disappeared, just like that mother down in Tokyo, who rather left Tokyo because of the radioactive fallout, is now being threatened by the Fukushima Prefecture's idiotic police department, who are going to send police 1,000 miles... to investigate a grandmother who tweeted she wasn't happy with the nuclear apologist, the nuclear lobbyist. And a lobbyist wouldn't even be allowed to exist if they didn't have an amendment to the slavery laws. Right? The reason they're getting away with everything on this planet, the reason why they're getting away with all these crimes against humanity, all these crimes against our universe, not just the ocean, not all the creatures in the ocean, not all the animals dependent upon the ocean, not just all the birds in the ocean, but our universe. Because we're trying to export this shit out into our Milky Way and universe when it's completely opposite of what the sun does. It's not a weapon, it's not a device, it's not something beneficial to society. And, yeah, okay, buddy, we'll catch you. And so we got to export, we got to stop this system before it exports it off the planet. We got to stop this system before it destroys all the organisms on this planet. This is self-destructive. It's a perpetual motion machine that can't be turned off unless we try. We don't even try. We don't even pretend to try. All we do is we make up apologies about bananas and walking in sunshine and potato chips and imply that somehow or another everything is going to be fairy dust if we just believe that fable. If we just smile, the radiation can't hurt us. Well, you might want to talk to Dr. Raymond Gilmedy from New Mexico, from Carlsbad, because he fed plutonium aerosols to beagles and beagle puppies for over 3 decades, almost 4 decades, and murdered them by them ingesting tiny particles, let them die of the cancers, analyzed it, autopsied it, took the samples of it, and still got it there. And he showed that even little itty bitty tiny bits of the man-made radioactive material unequivocally will give you cancer that will kill you, because it's ionized. It doesn't belong on the planet. There's no justifications for the lies. There's no justification for what the lawyers are doing. You can't justify that. Yeah, I work for a company, I'm a PR firm, that's what I do. No, you don't. It doesn't work that way. You don't get away with that deception and that lies. Those days are gone. It's over. The nuclear industry is history. It's over. You just as well give it up right now. It's dead. There's no more nuclear coming. It's gone. Because this planet is waking up and it can't be on this planet anymore in this context. It can't be any chain reactions on this planet ever again. We got to clean up the dumps in the ocean and try to deal with what we got done. Firing 2.5 million rounds of uranium-238 a month for 9 years in other people's countries. But nuclear's okay. Nuclear never harmed anybody. You might want to go down and talk to the children in Fallujah before you open your fucking mouth and give me that nonsense. Because they're going to tell you a different story and they probably can't even open their mouth because they were born without one. Born without arms, born without legs, born without feet, born without hope because of your complacency, your inability to do your job and to man up and owe up and hold your system accountable. To be a watchdog. Because you're obligated under your constitutions and your Bill of Rights and your Magna Carters. It is your obligation. It is you who are responsible. You are the one who are responsible. It is your voice they fear on top of that. Because you're responsible. Because you have power. And by you speaking out, you took away their power. You took away their authority. You took away their ability to contain you, control you, to manipulate you, and to keep you into a little box. When you spoke up and used your voice, you stepped out of your box, and you will never step back in that box again. You will never be able to be put back in that box again, and you will finally be free. You will be free. That, my friends, is the perpetual motion machine. It can't be stopped. Your freedom when you finally attain it. And you can't attain it until you rise to the occasion. And everybody will be tasked with that at some point in their life. And will you look back on your life and will you say, I wish? And if you think you will, then you need to do the right thing. And it doesn't matter who you are or what your background is. It matters what your moral is. It matters what your conscience is. And because it takes a conscience, it takes the ability to understand that this is not a game and that bananas got nothing to do with this and that the reason they would use, the only reason they could use that, besides the fact that every time I go to the supermarket, I feel their beady little eyes in my back in the banana section because, you know, they're pretty intimidating. They're like trucks. But see, the whole system fears you. It fears you. It fears your voice because the minute you use it, that means you don't buy into the system no more. And then that they got no control over you. And then you don't play the game anymore. It's like a boycott, divest, and a sanction. It's a very powerful thing. And wars have been fought over many times. And it's used as a weapon of war. And that's what you become. you become, you know, a conscientious objector just by withdrawing your support and by standing your ground, by speaking out against it, by educating others, by giving them, you know, lighting a fire. And you don't know who you could inspire. You don't know who you could... This is the whole thing throughout history that we know, is that you can inspire somebody that you don't know and you'll never know, and they may not even know you inspired them. And they will be the ones that could break the paradigm and the whole house of cards comes falling down and something wonderful could happen. Like, we deal with it. You know, I show you pictures of Chernobyl, of the conscripted, 600,000 conscripted, over a million went through this place. And they're going to go into a roof and they're going to get a 15-second, 20-second dose. And then they're going to go home. And then the next person's going to go out and he's going to do 15 seconds in the same spot. And they're going to share the dose that way. And he's going to go home. And he's going to probably lose hair, he's going to get sick, but he's going to recover and he's going to have a relatively normal life. He might not have children. He might be sterilized. He might have medical ailments for the rest of his life. But he might live for a long time. But when you take the homeless, like Fukushima, and you don't give them that, you know, you don't divide it up that way. You take them in there, you run them to the ground, day after day, week after week, not 15 seconds, and send them home. And you don't care about them. They're thrown away like trash. Yeah, well, that's like bananas, right? The people who are doing that are the same mentality and have the same, they deserve the same kind of attention or the same kind of disgust as the people who say bananas and walking in the sunshine and just using the normal everyday background radiation in this equation when it has nothing to do with it. It's so wrong. It's a crime against everything. It's a total crime against what their families raised them to do. Nobody would raise their kids to go out and lie and deceive and manipulate people like that. But every one of your university's professors that are active, that's what they do. Every nuclear scientist out there that's in the industry, that's what he's going to do. He's going to equate it with like a banana or walking in the sunshine. They're perpetual motion machines. They can't tell us the truth. It's incapable. And our media, of course, will only do whatever the PR machine told it to do. Because that's what they are. That's why they got all those PR courses. All your favorite talking heads prostitutes. All your favorite prostitutes out there, Bill O'Reilly or whoever. These are PR firms. Each and every one of them, the newscasters, do their own little, they have a company and they're PRs. That's what they do. And so they sell an image, a product, an ideology. And, you know, this is what we were up against. But we're not quite up against that anymore because the internet has balanced this out where people are moved away from this indoctrination machine that has been so effective for 40 to 50 years. At a relentless, unimaginable... So much money goes into how to brainwash you and manipulate you and to deceive you and get you to buy these stupid products that are poison for you. So, I'm going to end the stream right now because I didn't want a long stream tonight. I got a few things I got to do. But you got to think about your health. And so, you got to get away from GMO foods. You know, if there's nothing else you do, if you walk away and you don't talk about Fukushima, you never mention radiation for the rest of your life, you never look at the internet again for the rest of your life, right? You never hear these words again for the rest of your life. If you go out and you get the GMO out of your food, you go out and find the farmers markets, the people selling eggs, free range chickens. And you can buy the stuff and my dog, I cook my dog every meal. I don't cook the meat. I only cook the food just to heat it up 5 or 6 minutes. And I dice it all up. And so I make a meal a big meal, and I chop it in two, and I give my dog one in the morning and one later in the evening. Half and half, right? And so is rice and dandelion, and if I have meat, then it's going to be raw meat or raw oysters or raw this or raw that. That's how I always been. But now, because of the radiation and everything else, I've changed a lot of things. But I'm just saying, that's so much, you know, because your dog is getting GMO. Your children are getting GMO baby food. Most of everything in your supermarket is genetically modified. The diapers, the cotton that you're using, the pharmaceuticals are almost all GMO. Everything in your corner shop, all your gum, all your pop is genetically modified. Poop. It's poop. It's aspartame. It's noxic and toxic. And not only that, like, once again, they engineered 5 toxins into your GMO, and he took all the nutrients, you know, the vast majority of the percentages of it. Said it was 6,000 parts per million, and they left a couple of tiny parts, like 100 parts per million out of 600,000 or the 6,000 of calcium. They took it all out and engineered in toxins right into the DNA. And you have to stop eating that, because that fuels cancer. It fuels it. You can heal yourself. You can live. You can have a normal life if you can avoid that stuff. You can't avoid the radiation. It's everywhere. But if you eat nutrients and minerals, lots of it, like dandelion has every nutrient and every mineral your body craves. Everything is in that one plant, and you can eat the flower. Just pick it up and eat it. Eat the leaves, pick it up and eat it. And natural water out of the mountains. And everything's going to have radiation, and we can't escape that. There's no way to escape this. That's the truth. But the minerals and getting natural water, getting away from unstructured water and going finding wells and everything else and drinking, that's structured water. Anything that went to a machine loses its structure. And scientists don't know why it does that, but they know how to do it. They know how to flip it. They know how to turn the structure on again. And all it is realigning the molecules. But it's a really quite the phenomenon. And once again, mountain water was given to patients in hospital who were terminally ill. They took blood samples, gave them water. 20 minutes later, took another blood sample, gave them more water. 20 minutes later, took blood sample and gave them more water. And each time, right away, they seen the blood on plate and the blood act normal from just drinking mountain water that was taken from a mountain by helicopter, flown to a city and put in cast, taken on a plane, flown to a university, brought into a hospital the next morning, like 48 hours. And then they done these tests where they took the blood and put it under a microscope, and there it was. But they done this all over the world. They talked to institutions and universities. And you can structure water by talking to water, by saying, thank you, water. You are so kind, water. Or just being nice to water. And it's bizarre, like you talk to a plant. Well, if you talk to water, you can change the structure of it back. And I always say, thank you, water, when I get water. I always try to remember to say that. I know subconsciously I'll say it, but I try to say it out loud. Because I've seen so much, and I studied it so much, and I researched it so much. I know it's true. And you got springs and mountains. You got to get away from anything that was man-made. And you got to get back to normal vegetables. We used to eat 8,500 plants. Now we eat 7. And they got no calcium, no magnesium, no potassium. They got no iron. They got no carbon. They got it all engineered. Well, they got a little tiny parts per million left there. But they engineered in so it looks big and beautiful. They engineered in color. They engineered the exterior so it looks good. But a normal organic food doesn't look like that. Insects get at it and chew a bit out, and you chop that out. It's no big deal. It's what kids have done their entire lives, is chop worms out of apples and eat the apple. It never hurt nobody in our, because it's particularly the way we live. You're not going to see that very often. But that was out in Mother Nature, out in the woods, eating an apple off an apple tree, and that's how concerned you were about it. Now it's like you have to lock down the entire city and probably blow up a truck in there and have to evacuate North America. That's what the government would do, right? So a dirty bomb really is like a truck. It's not uranium-238 and plutonium or anything else. It's a truck. You can take a You know, so if you want to go, say, take over a country, you show up with trucks. Forget the tanks. Forget the Black Hawk helicopters shooting uranium-238 in the family homes and family cars and hospitals and institutions. You show up there in trucks like Chevys and Fords. You watch them run. They'll fucking run. They'll run. They'll see those trucks because they know. But they keep you dumbed down. They say trucks are okay. Right? And they say the same thing about radiation, but it's not true. No isotope, no radiation, no dose is so small that it can't give you cancer or can't be a problem for your health or can't trigger autoimmune deficiencies or won't trigger a massive release of white blood cells in your body trying to put it, entomb it, and put it in a sarcophagus. At what point are we going to stand up for ourselves? At what point are you going to use your weapon, your voice? And you make a 30-second video, and you see a headline you don't like, and you know it's a lie, you come out and you say, hey, I read your article, that's a lie, please fact check, have a nice day, take care, and then post your little video. That'll scare the Jesus out of them. That'll scare the daylights out of anything, because they're not used to that. And if you had 1,000 people do that, well, that'll be different, wouldn't it? You sort them out right quick. If you had a watchdog group out there with 1 million people doing that to these people, you can end this in about 30 days. You can shut all of their nonsense down and shut them down once and for all and retroactively destroy them for everything they said because the kitty litter is out of the bag. And so WIPP is trying to blame WIPP repository. I'm jumping back and forth. But WIPP New Mexico is trying to blame an explosion on kitty litter now. So you abandon the mine for 9 days because of a truck fire. And we're not supposed to think that's suspicious. And now you're going to say you abandon it for weeks and weeks and weeks because of kitty litter. Someone should take that bag of kitty litter and drown you in it. Like take you and haul you and start stuffing kitty litter down your fucking throat till it's coming out of your nose. Till you turn fucking blue in your face. And they got to put a fucking tube in your throat so you can fucking breathe. You have to do that and put that fucking video up on YouTube. Our government, our taxpayers be happy to pay for it. I'll give you a fucking kitty litter. Put a banana up your butt while we're doing it to you. And we'll be driving down the road in the back of a fucking truck. At 1,000 miles an hour and everybody arguing over who's going to put a seatbelt on and you're heading for a wall. The Fukushima plume provided a nice opportunity to test radioactivity detection capabilities. And I see that's the problem with me. That's the problem. Is I can take a picture or a single headline and go for 51 minutes. Just well for me to do 3 or 4 hour shows. Takes me an hour to get fucking warmed up anyway. It usually takes me half an hour to get mean. After that I'm pretty good. And you get some shit out of me. See, the problem is I got to come up, every time I do a show, I got to apologize for bananas. And I got to apologize for walking in the sunshine remarks. And I got to apologize for 70 years of homeostasis being thrown into E equals MC square equations. And I have to do that during the entire show. And I can never deviate because I need that there for context. Because that's what they do. They use it so much that I got 6 months of apologizing in every fucking show for bananas. 6 months of nonstop, every friggin' time, the first thing coming out of my mouth has to be about bananas and drinking water, homeostasis, and trendy iPhone chargers. I don't come over and say goodnight to everybody. That's it. My fucking throat is raw. I lit up my butt. Because I ain't got 4,000 chemicals. I got to apologize all the time for that. Ain't got no filter. So you've done 40, 50 years of academic peer review studies linking nicotine to cancer, and you can't. And there's 4,000 chemicals in the average cigarette, but you don't bother trying to link that to cancer. Why should we even not run you over on the side of the road when we seize you? Why should we not give a fuck about you? Why should we not be down there hanging you, at least by your foot anyway, from a pole? The people who are doing these studies and don't put that into the equation. Are they not the evilest people imaginable? Do you think they don't know there's 4,000 chemicals in a cigarette? Do you think that is what's wrong? Is that why after 4 or 5 decades of peer-reviewed academic studies around this entire planet, we still can't link nicotine? And because no scientist has ever worked out that, oh, you know, maybe, you know, it's a long shot, but one of those 4,000 chemicals that the EPA grandfathered in, along with 65,000 other chemicals in 1981 when they hung the shingle outside the door, just might be, you know, maybe carcinogenic, huh? Maybe? Do you? Huh? Do you? Huh? Do you really think maybe? Huh? Huh? Do you? Smoking a cigarette like a joint. I spit out the tobacco like a joint. Not that I know anything about that personally. Lawyer. And by the way, marijuana cures cancer. There's Harvard and Yale studies about that. And if people who are bigoted and racist and prejudiced against everything else, they'll probably hate the word marijuana. Hopefully you get cancer and somebody saves your life with marijuana. Anyway, I don't drive motorcycles anymore. I drive tricycles.
That's a bit of the tobacco like that.
Here we go. Sean ain't home. Krishna, free range kitty litter. I like it a lot. Adam, thank you, Adam. Kathy, lick your iPhone charger. Don't forget to apologize for that kitty litter, Kathy Reed says. Checks and balances. Good night, all. Yeah, I know I said good night earlier and I've done it to you again. I talked for 15 more minutes, so I better shut up and say good night. Grandma Goldie, solar mechanic. Hang them by their pole. Yeah, that's too funny. Hi, Ice Nine. The next show is Banana Split Sunday. Cherries on top, piano precious. Miss Milky, the clown one. Hi, honey. And she's a real busy girl. She's popping up some really great stuff. Miss Milky, the clown one. You'll find a link below. And you can look it up on the internet. And she gets a lot lately from Missing Sky 101. And Ping, good night, Ping. Anyone has funny kitty litter video, send them to Miss Milky. Oh, she's working on a stocking kitty litter video. That's hilarious. Yeah, good night, Lori. Mass Sterilization, Amthirst, John Townsend, Ketcher K, Sean ain't home. A banana split with a charger on it. James Beck, Original Punisher, Jill Clarkson, Standing Foot, Adam, Mr. I Can See, Liz Hound, Nip Killer, Grandma Goldie, Pedra, Liz Hound, MSVS, good night everybody, Sylvia, Jill Clarkson, Alex Smith, hey buddy, DC Babo, hey bud, and Kevin King, and everybody, hi Mickey. Yeah, drinking the dandelion. I'm drinking dandelion teeter right now, yeah. That's a fact. I picked it this morning. And all I do is I take the dandelion right out of the ground and give it a scrub and I chop it up. You know, I do like I slice it like you would getting kindling off a piece of wood where you slice off little tiny pieces. Yeah, and I just boil that up like that. And you can dice it up and just, I don't boil it hard. I only boil it, the dandelion, in like 4 or 5 cups of water, half boil, and as soon as it starts to boil, I'll turn it back to low and I'll let it simmer for about 40 minutes. And then I move it off the stove and I dip a cup in, and then take another cup of fresh water and I dump in that to replace it. And I'll do that 3 or 4 times and then I'll finish the pot as the day progresses. And you can down it, like you can get a coal and just down one for energy, for nutritions and minerals. And we catch everybody tomorrow night. I shouldn't say that because I'm not sure. What's the day? Hang on. I'm lost track now. Oh, yeah, it's Wednesday. You might see me tomorrow night. I'm going to try to do a little a little short 2-minute video just to get some kinks out of the system. And just a few little unique twists and turns in it. And just a different way of presenting the Fukushima facts. So it's about Fukushima facts. I'm not sure what I'll call it. It won't be Fukushima facts because John Townsend, Starlight. We'll catch everybody tomorrow night. I'm up to my 58 minute. I'm actually sweating here, so that's okay. That's all right by me. The audio, I meant to turn dial back that a little bit. As soon as I stop the stream, I'm going to dial that back. And tomorrow night it'll be a little bit lower. Hopefully it'll be a little more cleaner. And jeepers, computer froze. I miss Milky again. Night, night, hounds from Miss Milky. She gets the last word. Good night, everybody. And we'll throw Amthurs in there. My daughter got home from London today, and they hate Americans. No offense to Miss Milky. And we'll catch you folks in a video later tonight. I might miss it now because I'm stuttering my head off. I'm starting to feel it because I've been at this all day. But I got everything ready to go. I just got to do the audio, so I might get it out tonight or tomorrow morning for sure. And then I want to do a live stream tomorrow night. And I got a whole bunch of headlines I've been collecting for a couple of days on the nuclear industry. And I'm just going to do every one of them without going down my normal rant and rock and roll like I've been doing for last month. I got away from covering the headlines. I just hammer. Because I'm frustrated. And this can't sustain itself. It's untenable that we can keep this pace going. We're running out of homeless. Right? We can't stuff enough in the holes to stop anything. And so we have to stop it. Right? Collectively, we got to throw our bodies into the wheels and grind it to a halt and come to our common senses that with 4,800 peer-reviewed academic studies every day, if we tried, we could actually do something and change the game in the future, see? So we'll catch you folks later. Take care, everybody. Will I get loose? No, Google's not going to let me go that easy. Got to make me bow out. Isn't that the most uncomfortable thing ever? Where you got to say goodnight and then nothing happens and you got to sign in and do it again. I should have refreshed the pages, what I should have done. It would have made me do it. But where's the fun in that? Besides, I like to talk, so. Okay, take care, folks. 14th of May, 2014. We're up on Beautiful Girl by Dana, as we are many, many nights for the last 6 months, rallying. Trying to sort out the facts from the fission, like bananas. And you can catch this stream, if you catch it, and the comments are to your left of you with a small screen player, and the comments are rolling by, we are live streaming, and you should join into the conversation. And I usually start off warming up, waiting for everything to sync up by saying hi to as many people as I can. I check the audio. Hang on.
You're up on Beautiful Girl by Dana.
And we are good to go right there. Hi, Lori. Hi, Lunar. Mr. I Can See Candace. Piano Precious. Miss Frill, hi. John Art. Miss Frill's got a blog up there, folks. You should check out. John Townsend. Hi, bud. Mr. I Can See again, MSVS, what's up? Mr. I Can See too, Kevin O'Kane, Bob, hi Grandma, MSVS, Toxic, Lori, good evening folks, Bubba, Fukushima Revelations, Rick, oh, David, who else we got here, Kate, hi Kate, Kate runs Fukushima Hounds. You'll find links below, and just link below, check out her site. She's now a blogger, and she's awesome, and you really got to like her site over there. There's a lot of people over there. It's independent from me. Kate's running the site, and has put a lot of work into it, and she needs that support because she's making a difference and has put the time, energy, and effort, and monetary into that, and that's to be respected. And like everybody else out here, like Miss Milky, like Nubru Magic, like Kevin Blanche, like Thomas Ackerman, you know, like Susan Ducos down below from Before It's News, who supported us tirelessly and has been out there hammering away, like Radiation Chick, Christina Consolo, Rad Chick. You'll find her on YouTube under that handle, and you'll find her on Climate Viewer, and you'll find those links below. And you'll find Lori and Missing Sky 101, and you will find all kinds of people that are perpetual motion machines right now, that because of their souls and their hearts are so big that they care more about this entire planet than everything else, and they're willing to fight for it at all cost. And there's so many of you folks here. High Standing Foot, and we got Mickey, Masterization. Hey, bud. And that's a good name, hey, Masterization, because that's what they're up to. I've never seen a banana mutate a fruit fly. Have you seen a banana mutate a fruit fly? I know I haven't. And you won't. Because a banana's got nothing to do with the radiation that we talk about. And every night we have to apologize consistently, constantly. Hi, Adam. Hi, Liz, Kathy, Nepkiller, Adam, Ayul, Chris Cashin, Sir Car, I can't pronounce your name, you know that. We've been down this road before. And Eile Yusut, I never get your name, can I? After all these months, I still can't do it. Hi, Sergeant. And you folks are perpetual motion machines, yourselves. And the picture you see there is actually a picture of me in a Superman costume that somebody done up for me a while back. Shake Pie, you'll find him in my music section. Fantastic, inconceivably. And like, he's extremely talented for recording. Really, really talented people. And he had done that one up for me. I just listed all your favorite channels, Adam. Well, then you definitely know a thing or two, you know, and we'll be picking your mind later. Hi, Lori, Checks and Balances, and everybody, let's get started. It usually takes us 5 minutes. Oh, we're only 4 minutes and 38 seconds. Man, I got a couple more people here. They got to say hi before I can give it up. Who's out there? I see the numbers are starting to grow. Everybody knows I don't start till the first 4 or 5 minutes. So everybody's like, Dana's going to be yakking his head off for the first 5 minutes. It's the same thing every show, isn't it? That's pretty funny. Everybody got me worked out. So does that mean I got to stop doing that at the beginning of every show, doing my warm-up, my preamble to my screaming? Yeah? Calm your law, it's okay. Yeah, no, I hear you. You'll sit. Call you. See, and now you got two L's there. I haven't got no glasses on. How am I supposed to pronounce that? Do I look like a nuclear scientist to you or something? Huh? You probably got a truck waiting to start the truck. See, I didn't see that comment that until I looked up and I was talking to you. Start the truck. Look, I was coming down the road today and I seen a truck, and first I seen all these people running because obviously they seen the truck before I did. And so they were running and I was like, man, maybe this is a truck. Maybe this is the real thing. Right? Not about you, but it's every man for you. It's every person for themselves when you see a truck. Because like WIPP in New Mexico repository, when they had that radiation release, massive radiation release. Well, before that, for 9 days, they had a truck fire, 9 days previous, rather. And for 9 days, they didn't go back down in the WIPP repository where all the uranium-238, because that's what most of that is. It's not americium and it's not plutonium. Plutonium is just a tiny percentage. Do you think they're burying all this stuff that is transgenic, that is insignificant radiation, a half mile underground? Do you think that they're going to put this stupid shit? You know, you really got to take it into context. What's sitting on your ground? What's sitting at hand for just 450 billion gallons dumped into the soil? They're not even in containers. And by the way, everything at WIPP is vented. So everybody that works at WIPP in 10 or 15 or 20 years is going to get tumors and cysts. Anyway, I guess they were hoping they would all be down in the mine when it collapsed and they wouldn't have to pay out those medical expenses. But tough luck on that. Because you had a truck fire and everybody bailed for 9 days, right, at WIPP. I mean, that's a perpetual motion machine if I ever seen one, is a truck fire. So you have a truck fire and you got to abandon your cities and your highways and your communities. Do you really think we should have trucks anywhere in North America? Let's send them back to the hell they came from. You know, we should have an online campaign at the White House to ban pickup trucks and trucks. Like, if you're going to have to go abandon a huge, massive mine like at the WIPP repository in New Mexico, Carlsbad, because of a truck fire, think about, like, your car lot. That could probably take out most of North America if it goes up. Because they're trucks. And you say, Dana, that's foolishness. No, they evacuated the WIPP, that big site, hundreds of people, because of a truck fire. And you never went back down there, not even into the buildings on that massive site. Think about a site. Think about a football field. Well, there's 55 of those under the ground a half a mile down. And now when you have a truck fire, you think about how big these places are, right? The tunnels themselves, where they have the trucks. And there's massive wind going one direction, right? And so all you had normally would have done in a normal, like if it was a car, you could have got behind the car and put the car fire out. But because it was a truck fire, right, you had to abandon the site. Those things are, we allowed them to drive them around and they can contaminate the northern hemisphere if you have an accident with a truck. But we have so much confidence in them, we let them drive the trucks around. And then they find all this radioactive plumes, massive, unbelievable sizes, in updating your coastline, like an invisible snowstorm that lingered over your coastline. And you remember how I covered the Trans-Pacific pollution, how it gets exported across the Pacific, to the Pacific corridor, the wind corridors, not even getting up into the jet streams, even though it does. But the pollution from the buses and the trucks in the other countries, they got trucks down there. See, we need a campaign on this planet to ban trucks. Not nuclear misery, nuclear nightmare, nuclear agony, nuclear enemas. Because that's what you're doing to yourself. You're giving yourself, you're destroying yourself with this technology that provides 3% of electricity on this planet. You're destroying the planet. Because there's no creature on this planet can deal with this. Now you got this hemorrhaging into the ocean. Go ahead and verify it yourself. You find it in all kinds of mainstream media. You got Unit 1, 2, and 3, 100% meltdowns. 100%. Unit 1 lost its top. Unit 2 is intact, but no one will ever get in there again. And he built another sarcophagus around it. Because you will never see people working on these with scaffolding, with cutting torches. You won't see scaffold connection or steeplejack down there putting bids on that or working on it. You won't see the carpenter hall sending guys out to Fukushima to do construction. You're not going to see any rebuilding because the whole freaking place detonated, one right after another. Unit 3 is missing. That was MOX fuel. 2 million times worse than any other reactor on the planet. 2 million times worse. Let me say that. 2 million times. 2 million times worse than any other reactor on this planet, including Chernobyl. And by far Chernobyl. Chernobyl was nothing. It's nothing. It was one third the size of any of the reactors at Fukushima. It was a 30% meltdown of any of the reactors at Fukushima. Fukushima's are 100% meltdowns. So right away, they're three times worse. The fuel they're using at Fukushima is completely different. You're using graphite at Chernobyl. Chernobyl's got 3,600 square kilometers exclusion zone. And then the levels of cesium that they're talking about, the EPA in North America says you're allowed 7,400 becquerels a cubic meter in your drinking water. That's more than a cubic meter in the exclusion zone of Chernobyl. But Ken Buesler and Woods Hole Oceanographic Institution, Jay Cullen, all these other idiots, stupid dummies, murderers, maggots, parasites, cowards, stalkers, freaks, burden upon our society. They equate all this stuff with a ingest or getting an x-ray. Well, if you ingest it, you're getting an x-ray for the rest of your life, nonstop. When you get an x-ray, you walk out of the room, bye-bye, X-ray, kiss my butt, you know. I ain't scared of no X-ray. I'm terrified of ingesting radioactive particles because it sequesters into your organs. Living in an environment that we're living in now with high Becquerels of cubic meters throughout North America is unimaginable. 50 Becquerels cause permanent organ lesions living in that environment. A man-made. These isotopes don't exist on the moon. They don't exist in the sun. The sun doesn't create these isotopes. It creates elements. We destroy elements and create these creatures that don't exist in our solar system. They're not in our periodic tables. Yeah, we're trying to sketch them in now all these years later so people don't understand. But the entire nuclear industry is made up of lies and propaganda. Why do they have to come out and claim that a banana has something to do with a man-made radioactive isotope for? Why do they have to come out and claim that walking in the sunshine has something to do with man-made radioactive isotopes for? Why do they got to come out and claim that potatoes are one of the most radioactive food on the planet? And we eat it all the time and it doesn't hurt us. So why should we worry about releases from these man-made radioactive materials? Because they don't exist in our solar system. Because if you have a glass of drinking water, or a glass of water from the ocean, a glass of water from the ocean, you have 75 to 100 million phytoplankton. That's the very basis of the food chain. That's the very basis of oxygen. And if you take that out of the equation, everything else collapses. It's the house of cards. It's that one card in the house of cards will take the whole friggin' thing down. And we're not supposed to worry about it. We're supposed to put our fate that the system out there has our best interest in mind. When the hell was that ever a good idea? Would you run a company saying, oh, I won't check on my employees. They got my best interest in heart. I'll just leave my money sitting there. I'll just leave the beer coolers wide open and I'll go on down on vacation and I'm not going to worry about it because nobody would fucking do shit like that, right? Because we live in a perfect world where most of these people got the job, got the education so they can be a vulture, so they can get their hands on a checkbook, so they can get access to federal funding because they couldn't get a job serving french fries. They couldn't get a job sweeping my floor. I wouldn't feel safe with them on my street. I wouldn't feel safe with a nuclear scientist like a propagandist, apologist, in my community. Unless he was swinging from a pole. Legally, of course. Right? And I fully say that when I'm elected to president of the New World Order, we're going to make all our telephone poles with windmills on the top of them and good old-fashioned hanging hooks for all the apologists out there, because there is war crimes, tribunals, and crimes coming down the road for these creatures, for what they've done to that ocean, for what they're doing to this planet, for what they've done to our countries, for what our governments have done to us, for what, it's not our government, because they don't know any better, and they're stifled, a lot of them, by national security laws. You can't really blame a lot of these people because they can't open their mouth because under the national security, they could be disappeared just like that mother down in Tokyo who rather left Tokyo because of the radioactive fallout is now being threatened by the Fukushima Prefecture's idiotic police department who are going to send police 1,000 miles to investigate a grandmother who tweeted she wasn't happy with the nuclear apologist and nuclear lobbyist. And a lobbyist wouldn't even be allowed to exist if they didn't have an amendment to the slavery laws. Right? The reason they're getting away with everything on this planet, the reason why they're getting away with all these crimes against humanity, all these crimes against our universe, not just the ocean, not all the creatures in the ocean, not all the animals dependent upon the ocean, not just all the birds in the ocean, but our universe. Because we're trying to export this shit out into our Milky Way universe when it's completely opposite of what the sun does. It's not a weapon. It's not a device. It's not something beneficial to society. And, yeah, okay, buddy, we'll catch you. And so we got to export. We got to stop this system before it exports it off the planet. We got to stop this system before it destroys all the organisms on this planet. This is self-destructive. It's a perpetual motion machine that can't be turned off unless we try. We don't even try. We don't even pretend to try. All we do is we make up apologies about bananas and walking in sunshine and potato chips and imply that somehow or another homes and everything else. But they won't go look for Fukushima. They won't go look at all the radiation as I really landed in this country, in North America. No, I talk about Canada and I talk about United States and I don't talk about Vietnam. I don't talk about the Baltic Sea. I don't talk about a lot of the other countries. I kind of broach on it a little bit here and there, but I don't, that doesn't become part of the narrative. And we should always, you know, take that into account when you're thinking about Fukushima. It's not just Japan. It's not just Canada. We're already privileged beyond imagination. And it's not the Americans. And they're privileged beyond imaginations. And Americans are using up about 26% of the resources used every year, every day, on this planet. Just under 5% of the population, right? But I just wanted to run through the headlines, and there it is. I'm transferring everything onto the other the new computer. Now, when I talk about jet streams, I want you to remember one thing, that they're real, and that they're well known, and that even though the apologists, the nuclear bootlickers out there don't want to talk about it, because that's too tangible, you can understand a jet stream. At 100 miles an hour in 24 hours is 2,400 miles. In 2 days, in 4,800, it's 4,800 miles. In 3 days, it's halfway across North America. So if it's coming from Japan, in the air, it's 24 hours, 2,400 miles. If it's coming in the sea, in 1 day, it's going to move about 24 miles because the currents move at a mile per hour. And so the currents at a mile per hour, perpetual motion machine, every day it's hemorrhaging into the ocean at the rate of about 1,000 pounds of radioactive, think of radioactive dye like St. Paddy's Day going into the ocean or into a 4,000 mile river. And so you're at the top of that 4,000 mile river, you're going to dump every minute one truckload into the river. You got to get the truck out of the way, another truck out of backup, dump it in. You're going to do that every minute, nonstop, like a perpetual motion machine until the end of time. And as you, as years roll by, year one, that's a lot of dye. How far down that river do you think at the end of the year you're going to go before you stop seeing dye? If it's 4,000 miles long and you dump dye, you know, a truckload of dye that didn't salute into the water, it wasn't salutable, didn't dissolve, it maintained its color and its intensity, and it was radioactive. Because radiation is invisible and you can't see it, smell it, hear it, pick it up, taste it, feel it, kick it around, play with it, bite it, smack it, put it in your pocket, you don't know, it could be there. It seems innocuous and benign, right? But it's not, because it's so small that it's smaller than the dust in your house that floats around in the air. It's smaller than that, and you need a really sunny day and bright windows to see that dust in your house. And, but it's much smaller than that. It's at 1/10,000th of a millionth of a meter, and that stuff is only microns. We're not even down to the nanoparticles with the stuff you can see. Once it gets down to the nanos, you can't see it. But it gets down to the sub-nanos, it gets down to 1/10,000th of a millionth of a meter, and you need extraordinarily sophisticated devices. So I want you to think about it. That if you got a Geiger counter, and so Geiger counter got some uses, even though I don't put them on much of a pedestal, but they got a lot of uses, because at least they can make you aware, and if you're in a really bad area, it will probably save your life. And so there's nothing wrong with it, but you have to learn how to use it. Remember a Geiger counter, that if you sniff it inappropriately, I know that sounds pretty naughty, but if you use what you call sniffing, because it sniffs into particles, and then they have to react with the gases that are in there, right? And so what you got to remember going on there is that you can excite these things and throw it off its calibration. And by rights, you should have it calibrated to look for specific isotopes, to find them the ones you're not going to be released, but you're looking for gammas or you're looking for betas. Most of the Geiger counters out there are not looking for both of those, but they can, some of them. And it's not going to tell you what it is. But so a long story short would be that if I had a glass of water and it had 7,500 becquerels potassium 40 in it, and I had another glass of water and it had 7,500 becquerels potassium 40 and it had a single atom or a particle of cesium-137 or strontium or any of these other man-made radioactive isotopes, and you took your Geiger counter, when you put it up to the one with just the drinking water, and you drank the 7,500 becquerels of potassium 40, you off-gassed that because it's homeostasis and it's insignificant. Your body can't hold any more potassium 40. But the Geiger counter can't read that. You got to take a cubic meter of water, you have to dry it out, weigh the potassium 40, and for every gram, you're going to put 25 becquerels of potassium 40 into the equation. But everything got potassium 40 into it. So the other glass, now it's got potassium 40, so your Geiger counter is not going to work on that either. But if it's got becquerels of cesium or strontium or uranium or plutonium or any of the creatures, any of the 3,100 or the, say there's 3,100 isotopes, 260 of them are normal. And they're so benign, so harmless, so insignificant. One has to wonder why we keep hearing these words. So you can take your Geiger counter. You're not going to find thorium, you know, that kelp watch the UC Berkeley was talking about. You got to dry it out, right, and weigh the stuff out. You're not going to find barium-7 on your Geiger counter because it's so insignificant. It's indigenous. It's solar rays. It's stupid. But that one with the cesium-137, your Geiger counter is going to go beep every second. And if there was 7,500 becquerels of cesium in there, your Geiger counter is going to go every second. Now, if you drink, now say you got none of this stuff in you, and you take the Geiger counter and you go up to yourself and you go, yeah, I got no beep beeps going on here with the Geiger counter on your body. Just like, I want you to think that way anyway. Even though that might not be true because of the way they detect these things, you got to take your kidney out and dissect it and everything else. But I just want you to escape that train of thought so that you can actually understand what I'm trying to say to you. Is that if you drink the one with the cesium-137 in it, right, you're going to have a becquerel inside of you, an extra becquerel. So your body can't hold any more potassium-40, but there's no limit on how much cesium you can put in your body. There's no homeostasis attached to the cesium. And there was 30 times more strontium with the cesium. 30 times more. And a lot of people say, where's your proof that this stuff came across? Well, evidence of sharp features in the Fukushima plume over southwestern British Columbia was a study by Health Canada. And you'll find links below the video. And I remember to put the links there tonight. And I got the links in under the last one. Because I forget sometimes too. Several studies on the radioactive release in Fukushima nuclear power plant already exist. The Fukushima plume, this is Health Canada, March the 18th and the 19th. The Fukushima plume provided a nice opportunity to test radioactivity detection capabilities. That's the most twisted thing imaginable. We didn't pay them to get out there and test it and find it and not tell us. We gave them all that equipment. We gave them all that funding. We gave them their pensions and their paychecks. We gave them those offices and those trucks. And just think about how dangerous. And then they probably made up a radiation release. There's probably no radiation release at WIPP. It was the fucking truck. And they don't want to tell you that because there's trucks all over the highway. And trucks in your community. You go and look around. You'll see them everywhere. They're out there. I seen one today. Okay, I can't keep going like that, sorry. Yeah, that's Al-Qaeda stuff, you know? Saying that trucks are bad. Just like saying radiation is bad, that no matter what you do, you can't escape it. Hi, Sean, and everybody else, let me come over and say, they got to ban iPhone chargers too. right? Because WIPP said it's cool and it's trendy and everybody's got to do it, you got to lick that iPhone charger. Yeah, lick their fucking iPhone chargers. Because WIPP said it's cool. They said at the WIPP repository that you would get more radiation if you licked your iPhone charger, from licking your iPhone charger. And if I had my Wirecast running, blah, that's got me ran to the ground. It's been a rough couple of weeks trying to get that shit to work, you know. It really took the good out of me. But I'm still pounding away at it. Oh, let me get rid of that. And I was doing a Wirecast today to make a documentary for everybody. And I got a new, I can't tell you because, but I couldn't find a picture of it on the internet. And so I created one, and it's authentic picture, and I'm not going to tell you anymore because I'm going to try to get that video out tonight. After we stream, I'm going to sit there and do the audio. I don't care what it's like. I don't care how bad it is. I'm just going to put it out there, no matter what. It's coming out tonight. I got to stay up all night. That little short video is going to come out. And I'm going to be creating a lot of these short videos. I'll get busy here in a second, folks. And I know everybody really don't care, but the people don't know any better. You know, the WIPP repository had released a massive amount of radiation. They blamed it on, and they said nothing happened for 9 days. And they said they had a truck fire, and that's why they didn't go back down in the mine. And, you know me, I'm a curious kind of a guy. And I seen Hollywood movies, and they had truck fires, and people didn't have to evacuate big areas. And so I was like, well, maybe I better go out and look this stuff up. And then I seen a picture on the internet of firefighters putting the truck out, and I think that was photoshopped. I think they photoshopped it, uploaded the internet to fool people like us. Because trucks are the most dangerous things on the planet. Not the 45-gallon barrels of uranium-238 with americium, neptunium, plutoniums, and all their daughters with the thousands of years of half-life. And by the way, a half-life is times 10. Minimum. So if it's whatever it is, it's times 10. So why do they call it a half-life in the context of when they're explaining things to you then? Amongst themselves, because they know academically what it means, it's okay, right? But to come out and constantly deceive you for 70 years, and now we find out that half-life is times 10. So if it's a 30-year half-life for strontium and cesium, and strontium goes right into your bones, right? It goes into your groin, gets in, which because you're making your white blood cells down there, and you're making your bone marrow there. Well, you make white blood cells everywhere actually in your joints, not only your spleen. I ain't got no spleen. I don't need no stinking spleen. Yeah, I got mine taken out when I was young. Like, you know how most people go and get a tattoo? I went and got my spleen removed. Because I thought that was more trendy. I'm pretty tough, right? I don't have no friggin' anesthetic. Just reach in there and get that old spleen out of me. I want to pickle it and put it on my shelf. And today, that's where it sits. On a dusty old shelf on the east coast of Canada. Sitting there right now, because nobody else got a use for it, I can assure you. You think I'm making that up, don't you? Okay, well, I made a little tiny bit of that part up. Actually, I lost my spleen in a motorcycle accident. And I slid up the handlebars and slammed into a... And the handlebars went in my stomach. And then the bike flipped. And it tossed me about 25 feet or something. About 10 feet up in the air and on a bank. And so I started to bleed to death. Because I had ruptured my spleen, tore from my body cavity, right? And so the bike was down there screaming. I don't know why I'm telling you this story, but anyway, the bike was down there screaming. And so I kept passing out. And I would wake up and I hear the bike. And so I try to go to the bike to shut it off. And I pass out again. I'd done that probably 20 times. And so by and by I got to the bike. And then I drove the bike to the first house, and the bike was all smashed up, and I went in, and the girl who came out, she thought I was faking, and her dad came out, and she was like 25 or something, I don't know why she thought that, but anyway, her dad came out, and he looked at the bike, And he called her an idiot or something. And he said, get the car keys. And so he realized this was serious, and he took me to the hospital. And every rock in the road, I felt it. I don't know why I'm telling you this, but... So anyway, I get in the hospital, and it's my spleen. I had lost, I can't remember how much blood, but lost a lot of blood in my cavity. So it was filled up. I had turned gold colors. And I had said to the doctor, they were doing an x-ray, and I said, I'm going to puke. And he said, no, you're not. And I covered him in puke. Just, bah! And he laughed at me. And so did the nurses, because I told him I was going to puke, and he wouldn't give me a bucket, and I puked. It was lucky for me anyway, right? And so I had surgery and broke, the bike never ran again. So the bike made it out. It kept running, right? And so it consciously woke me up each time. And finally, I made it out and got on the bike. I pulled the clutch in, dropped the gear down. I drove it out to the first house. And that bike never started again. And it was not even good for scrap. But it ran perfect out to that first house. I remember that distinctly. Anyway, let me keep going. There was a point to me telling you that story, by the way. I don't know what it is anymore. Oh, yeah. It was the first ride of spring, and I was coming down a hill, and the rain had washed out the bank, and there was a rock sticking out of the bank, but it was still covered in mud, so you couldn't notice it. And so there's a big, huge, massive puddle of water there and mud. And I went up alongside the bank, and the tire hit that, and then turned, and then I slid up and stuck the handlebars in my guts and threw me for a somersault. But prior to that, I used to go out and drive around town and look for cop cars and get them to chase me. I had XL500, and I bought the biggest, knobbiest tires I could at a North American, ordered them, brought them in there, and got them all nice and pretty. And I used to go out and look for them. And there was nothing I wouldn't do like more than go out and find the boys in blue and get them to try to chase me. And so that's how bored we were. That's after I had moved over to the other side of Newfoundland when I was older. That's what I thought. That's what I considered fun. And I had done that, I know, about 16 times in just one period. And I mean, if things had got dangerous, I would have stopped. That was always the plan, right? But there was no way to catch me. And so these guys are from the mainland. And they don't know the territory, and I knew all the locals, and I knew the territory, and they couldn't go where I could. So it was just better aggravating them. But in those days, the police wouldn't beat you up. Police wouldn't pull a gun on you. Police wouldn't pick you up and throw you down on your head till your head was cracked open and you died. Right? If they didn't get you, they didn't get you. Now they would send up the drone. Everything is going to be fairy dust if we just believe that fable. If we just smile, the radiation can't hurt us. Well, you might want to talk to Dr. Raymond Gilmedy from New Mexico, from Carlsbad, because he fed plutonium aerosols to beagles and beagle puppies for over 3 decades, almost 4 decades, and murdered them by them ingesting tiny particles, let them die of the cancers, analyzed it, autopsied it, took the samples of it, and still got it there. And it showed that even little itty bitty tiny bits of the man-made radioactive material unequivocally will give you cancer that will kill you, because it's ionized. It doesn't belong on the planet. There's no justifications for the lies. There's no justification for what the lawyers are doing. You can't justify that. Yeah, I work for a company, I'm a PR firm, that's what I do. No, you don't. It doesn't work that way. You don't get away with that deception and that lies. Those days are gone. It's over. The nuclear industry is history. It's over. You just as well give it up right now. It's dead. There's no more nuclear coming. It's gone. Because this planet is waking up, and it can't be on this planet anymore in this context. It can't be any chain reactions on this planet ever again. We got to clean up the dumps in the ocean and try to deal with what we got done. Firing 2.5 million rounds of uranium-238 a month for 9 years in other people's countries. But nuclear's okay. Nuclear never harmed anybody. You might want to go down and talk to the children in Fallujah before you open your fucking mouth and give me that nonsense. because they're going to tell you a different story, and they probably can't even open their mouth because they were born without one. Born without arms, born without legs, born without feet, born without hope because of your complacency, your inability to do your job and to man up and owe up and hold your system accountable, to be a watchdog. Because you're obligated under your constitutions and your Bill of Rights and your Magna Carters. It is your obligation. It is you who are responsible. You are the one who are responsible. It is your voice they fear on top of that, because you're responsible, because you have power. And by you speaking out, you took away their power. You took away their authority. You took away their ability to contain you, control you, to manipulate you, and to keep you into a little box. When you spoke up and used your voice, you stepped out of your box, and you will never step back in that box again. You will never be able to be put back in that box again, and you will finally be free. You will be free. That, my friends, is the perpetual motion machine. It can't be stopped, your freedom, when you finally attain it. And you can't attain it until you rise to the occasion. And everybody will be tasked with that at some point in their life. And will you look back on your life and will you say, I wish? And if you think you will, then you need to do the right thing. And it doesn't matter who you are or what your background is. It matters what your moral is. It matters what your conscience is. And because it takes a conscience, it takes the ability to understand that this is not a game, and that bananas got nothing to do with this, and that the only reason they could use that, besides the fact that every time I go to the supermarket, I feel their beady little eyes in my back in the banana section, because, you know, they're pretty intimidating. They're like trucks. But, see, the whole system fears you. It fears you. It fears your voice. Because the minute you use it, that means you don't buy into the system no more. And then that they got no control over you. And then you don't play the game anymore. It's like a boycott, divest, and a sanction. It's a very powerful thing. And wars have been fought over many times. And it's used as a weapon of war. And that's what you become. You become, you know, a conscientious objector just by withdrawing your support and by standing your ground, by speaking out against it, by educating others, by giving them, you know, lighting a fire. And you don't know who you could inspire. You don't know who you could. This is the whole thing throughout history that we know, is that you can inspire somebody that you don't know and you'll never know, and they may not even know you inspired them. And they will be the ones that could break the paradigm, and the whole house of cards comes falling down, and something wonderful could happen. Like, we deal with it. You know, I show you pictures of Chernobyl, of the conscripted, 600,000 conscripted, over a million went through this place. And they're going to go into a roof, and they're going to get a 15-second, 20-second dose. And then they're going to go home. And then the next person is going to go out, and he's going to do 15 seconds in the same spot. And they're going to share the dose that way. And he's going to go home. And he's going to probably lose hair. He's going to get sick. But he's going to recover. And he's going to have a relatively normal life. He might not have children. He might be sterilized. He might have medical ailments for the rest of his life. But he might live for a long time. But when you take the homeless like Fukushima, and you don't give them that. You know, you don't divide it up that way. You take them in there. You run them to the ground. Day after day, week after week, not 15 seconds and send them home. And you don't care about them. They're thrown away like trash. Yeah, well, that's like bananas, right? The people who are doing that are the same mentality and have the same, they deserve the same kind of attention or the same kind of disgust as the people who say bananas and walking in the sunshine and just using a normal everyday background radiation in this equation when it has nothing to do with it. It's so wrong. It's such a crime against everything It's a total crime against what their families raised them to do. Nobody would raise their kids to go out and lie and deceive and manipulate people like that. But every one of your university's professors that are active, that's what they do. Every nuclear scientist out there that's in the industry, that's what he's going to do. He's going to equate it with like a banana or walking in the sunshine. They're perpetual motion machines. They can't tell us the truth. It's incapable. And our media, of course, will only do whatever the PR machine told it to do. Because that's what they are. That's why they got all those PR courses. All your favorite talking heads prostitutes. All your favorite prostitutes out there, Bill O'Reilly, whoever. These are PR firms. They're each and every one of them. The newscasters, they're their own little, they have a company, and they're PRs. That's what they do. And so they sell an image, a product, an ideology. And, you know, this is what we were up against. But we're not quite up against that anymore because the internet has balanced this out where people are moved away from this indoctrination machine that has been so effective for 40 to 50 years at a relentless, unimaginable. So much money goes into how to brainwash you and manipulate you and to deceive you and get you to buy these stupid products that are poison for you. So, I'm going to end the stream right now because I didn't want a long stream tonight. I got a few things I got to do. To be a watchdog. Because you're obligated under your constitutions and your Bill of Rights and your Magna Carters. It is your obligation. It is you who are responsible. You are the one who are responsible. It is your voice they fear on top of that because you're responsible because you have power. And by you speaking out, you took away their power. You took away their authority. You took away their ability to contain you, control you, to manipulate you, and to keep you into a little box. When you spoke up and used your voice, you stepped out of your box and you will never step back in that box again. You will never be able to be put back in that box again. And you will finally be free. You will be free. That, my friends, is the perpetual motion machine. It can't be stopped. Your freedom when you finally attain it. And you can't attain it until you rise to the occasion. And everybody will be tasked with that at some point in their life. And will you look back on your life and will you say, I wish? And if you think you will, then you need to do the right thing. And it doesn't matter who you are or what your background is. It matters what your moral is. It matters what your conscience is. And because it takes a conscience. It takes the ability to understand that this is not a game and that bananas got nothing to do with this and that the only reason they could use that, besides the fact that every time I go to the supermarket, I feel their beady little eyes in my back, in the banana section, because, you know, they're pretty intimidating. They're like trucks. But, see, the whole system fears you. It fears you. It fears your voice. Because the minute you use it, that means you don't buy into the system no more. And then that they got no control over you. And then you don't play the game anymore. It's like a boycott, divest, and a sanction. It's a very powerful thing. And wars have been fought over many times and is used as a weapon of war. And that's what you become. You become, you know, a conscientious objector just by withdrawing your support and by standing your ground, by speaking out against it, by educating others, by giving them, you know, lighting a fire. And you don't know who you could inspire.